Joe Amaral, who has been coming here for a number of years, Joe.
Yeah.
When you were just a beginning in ministry and an upstart author.
That's right.
And now, my goodness, you have one of the leading publishers in the United States. In fact, my old boss, John Maxwell, is with the same publisher.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and he's a New York Times bestselling author many times over.
Yes.
And so they know how to select authors. And Joe, this book, Understanding Jesus, has done so very, very well. What do you welcome, by the way?
Well, thank you. And let me say that, you know, I'd love to say that it was because, you know, I'm so awesome that they heard about me. I'd like to say that, but I can't, not honestly. It was because I came here on Huntley Street quite a few years ago now, and you guys were featuring the self-published version of the book, you know, as kind of the monthly gift for the partners. And it sold so many copies that it got the attention of this very large publisher in the U.S. And so I'm so thankful for this ministry and what it has done for me.
And that's all made possible, Joe, because of
the viewers.
Of you, the viewers. And so please, before we get into the interview, I'll remind you the phone number. There are people waiting to hear from you. 1-888-288-0003, 1-888-288-0003. You want to call, and today, if the Lord so leads you, and help us with a gift or a monthly partnership that allows us to have these kind of interviews with Joe and others. Joe, this book, Understanding Jesus, Cultural Insights into the Words and Deeds of Christ, you follow Jesus in his ministry, and when Jesus begins his ministry, it's not too long after that we encounter miracles beginning to take place.
Right, absolutely.
So there are some messianic miracles, and in this segment, let's get to two of them. What's the first one? There was a healing that took place, correct?
Yeah. Well, before we start identifying what they were, let's identify what a messianic miracle general is.
All right.
You know, because Israel were looking for a savior. They were looking for this Messiah to come. I mentioned it yesterday because they were being oppressed by the Romans, and they were being crushed. They were being overtaxed. Their religion was being suppressed, all kinds of things. And they wanted somebody, this promised seed of David, who would come and set them free. And basically, whatever miracles the rabbis and the local priests could not do, they began to attribute to this Messiah. When he came, only he would be able to do it. And the first one is actually, it's quite powerful. But when you read it, John, just, you know, kind of in the English and in the westernized version, you think, it's a cool miracle and nothing super.
Yeah.
And if you notice, sometimes Jesus does miracles that people really react to. Others, they go, oh, that was cool. And they kind of go on and go have a falafel, you know?
Right.
Like, for instance, you know, when Jesus sees the widow with her son going to bury the boy, he has compassion on her, and he touches the boy, raises him to life, and not a word.
Yeah?
What would you do if you saw somebody go to a casket and touch the body and it raised back to life? We'd freak out.
Be held in awe.
Yeah, and this happens in nothing. And so I began to look at them and say, why the reaction and the non-reaction?
Right.
And so one of the messianic miracles was considered to happen if somebody could cast out a demon that made a person mute. And you think, well, why is that such a big deal? I mean, aren't there more powerful demons? Aren't there bigger miracles that he could do? And we have to understand that Jesus, as a Jewish rabbi living in that time, operates according to the methodology, to the way people we're expecting in those days.
All cultural related, cultural sensitivities.
Absolutely. I mean, you've traveled a lot. You've learned a lot about being sensitive to the local culture.
Absolutely.
So, you know, Jesus comes in and, you know, he casts out this mute spirit, and everybody gets so shocked. If somebody was demon possessed in those times, what would happen is you would bring the person in before the priests or the rabbis. And the rabbi, this sounds very unusual, but this is how they did it in those days. They would speak to the demon in the person, and they would say, what is your name? And the demon would respond, and they would cast out that demon by its own name. So if you remember, Jesus asked on several occasions, what is your name? We are legion. And then even he was accused, they said, you're casting out Beelzebub by Beelzebub. They were referring to the system that was in place.
Right.
Now, what if I have a demon that makes me mute? And you ask me, you ask the demon in me, what's your name? And I can't speak. You ask again, what's your name? I can't speak. The thought and the theology of the day was, I'm sorry, man, you're stuck.
Yeah.
This demon's not coming out because we can't cast it out by its own name. And so they said, well, The only person who could do this then will be the Messiah. God in the flesh is the only one who'll have so much authority that he'll even speak to demons directly and cast them out. And that's why when Matthew records this miracle, he says, who was hurt? No one has ever, now you know, it's been a long time, it's been years. Yeah. No one has ever heard of such a thing in all of Israel. And if we don't know the culture, John, if we don't know the messianic expectations in the background, we totally miss something so powerful.
We have a couple of minutes left in this segment, Joe. Talk to us about the man born blind.
Oh boy, I'm a preacher and I got 2 minutes. All right, here we go. Yep. This was another messianic miracle because blindness at birth was seen as a curse because of sin in the life of your parents. So if a child was born blind, they would say, what did your parents do before marriage? What kind of generational curses are in your family? It was such a shame on the family. And so again, because it was a curse because of sin, only God could forgive sin. Therefore, only God could remove this curse of blindness from birth. And you know the story of the man who's in the temple courts. Jesus comes to him, heals him, and then he walks away. And he starts telling everybody he's healed. And the priests come and they say, you know, are you sure you were born blind? And the guy's like, yeah, pretty sure. Couldn't see till a few seconds ago. And they're trying to, they want to confirm, were you born blind? Who healed you?
Yeah.
He said, listen, I'm not trying to be, you know, a smart guy about it, but I was blind. I don't know who touched me. I couldn't see who it is. All I know is I was blind and now I see. And they even called for the boy's parents. Was he born blind? Mm. They want to verify. Not because they're being facetious or whatever. Yeah. They want to know.
Yeah.
And so we have the casting out of the mute spirit and the healing of a person born blind. And Jesus seems to systematically go after these miracles.
Well, you did well for 2 minutes. Whew. Yeah, praise God. You did great for 2 minutes. Now, here's the story. Today, when you call and you commit to help us financially, whatever the Lord lays upon your heart, we're looking for monthly members for $30 a month, $60 a month, $100 a month. Some of you may be led to the Lord to follow the challenge. Many are following this challenge that we've been making of a one-time special gift in honor of our 10,000th episode season of a gift of $1,000. Whatever the gift is, though, we want to send you this book where you get more than just 2 minutes of Joe. You get all of Joe you want here with this great book, Understanding Jesus, 1-888-288-0003. That's 1-888-288-0003. Please help us today, all across Canada, all across the United States. We would be so grateful.